This is a Pod Dealers Network podcast.
All right, so real quick, this is not going to make sense at all right now or even by the end of this episode. It may not really make sense for a while, but I promise you, I did not plan any of this. It just happened this way. Please remember that.
What is TWS podcast, episode, whatever, who cares at this point?
The rant with the vindicator.
It's my podcast, I do what I want to.
People, listen.
Word, is it still live?
It's not working for me, Rich. All right, we're going to keep going.
I know I changed my voice at work.
Bars on the radio.
What is TWS podcast?
One's ready. I feel like the end is staring at my watch and I'm feeling so new school.
Suicide attempts, how many tries to take?
Damn, ready.
Girl, I know you could freak me in the morning. I mean, everybody can, but they don't know how to make love to me, love to me. Girl, I need you to do more for me, more for me. I'ma take you places you don't go. Introduce you to some people you don't know. Used to call you on the phone, I call you baby now. You ain't been the same since I came around. Girl, you know you fucking with the goat. Know you like the any down your throat, throat, throat. Brought a pre-roll, know you love to smoke, smoke, smoke. Bring your girlfriend if they gon' go, go, go.
Don't cry, the river runs dry, but the river gon' flow tonight. I'm done. No more singing. Welcome to another episode of the What Is TWS podcast. As always, I'm your boy, J.Dot Flan, representing the White Pants Society. And I want to thank you, first and foremost, for giving me a little bit of your time so we can talk through some things, have a little fun. I don't know, whatever. You could be anywhere else in the world, but you're here with me, and I appreciate you for it. So let's get into this episode. Man, I got a couple things I want to talk about, a lot to talk about. Interesting things to talk about. We'll start off with my normal Chef Elise update. Again, had my visit this week, which is always, you know, like my highlight of the week. We were supposed to make orange cream cupcakes this week. You know, we talked about it. I think she really wanted to make cupcakes last week. I didn't have everything that we needed to do it. You know, so I asked her, like, what kind of cupcakes she wanted to make. And I don't know, whatever, for whatever reason, she went with orange. So that was the plan. I bought all the ingredients that we needed. I got a whole bag of oranges down there that I now have to figure out something to do with. But I bought all the ingredients. I got the recipe ready. And she got here. And she ain't bring it up. And I was too tired to remind her. So no recipe this week. Nothing serious. Nothing. No pictures to share. We didn't do any of that. We did, however, have our normal smoothie tea party. That's become our thing. Like, as soon as she gets here, we make smoothies. We put them in these little cups. We have a tea party. Pinkies up, all that good stuff. It's pretty dope. But this week, Chef Elise decided to do something a little different. We put the smoothie in one big cup, and then we did the two straws, and then she added her little signature garnish, the strawberry top. And it was a real cute, like, daddy-daughter moment. We did, like, the milkshake with two straws kind of thing. I actually don't even really know if I've ever done that, like, romantically before. Like, I don't know if I've ever done that, you know, with a woman I was dating or anything like that. I feel like maybe it's something, you know, her mom and I may have done, but I don't know. Knowing the way I am about food and sharing, maybe not. I mean, just to explain that, I don't know, like, I was a picky eater growing up, and, you know, like, food that I do eat is important to me. Like, I get what I know I want, and I get the amount of what I want so that I will no longer be hungry once I'm finished consuming that food. And, like, there is this thing, and ladies, maybe you can explain it to me. There is this some of yours syndrome that a lot of you seem to have where it's not necessary. I don't even know that you want the food that we have. Like, you want some of it. Like, you just need to know that you can have it. And the only way to find out is to ask for it or take it. And so, yeah, there's always this, you know, some of yours thing where I get exactly what I want. And I ask you, what do you want? I will get you exactly what you want whatever you want, however much of it you want. And somehow I always end up not getting everything that I wanted because you got to have some of mine. And I don't want any of yours. Like, I just don't. Like, you know, I'm a picky eater. I got exactly what I wanted. I most likely don't want what you have. So we can't do like the fair trade and share alike. Nah, like, stay over there, please. Speaking of relationships, in other news, this is a big one for me. I kind of met someone. I think I'm in a relationship, situationship, whatever. I don't know what people call this shit these days. I think I'm too old for titles and stuff. We ain't doing a boyfriend, girlfriend thing. I don't know what it, I don't know if we're there. Or I don't understand any of this. I've been out the game for so long that this is all weird to me. I really thought that I was like done with the whole dating deal. Like I had reached a place where like, if that was it for me, like, I guess I was like that, you know, the aging athlete that was just like, man, I look back on my career and I've accomplished enough that, you know, I could walk away from it now and like never, you know, never get back into that world. And that's where I was. Like, I was like, you know what, you know, in terms of relationships and romance and all that, yeah, I think my resume is good. I did some good things, had some bad times, had some good times, you know, won a couple championships, whatever. But I think I'm good. I think I can walk away from it all. And that's where I was. And then this situation kind of popped up. And, you know, I don't know. I don't know if it was the meds or, you know, if I really was just ready or missing, you know, that part of my life. But yeah, I decided to step out there. And things are going pretty well so far. You know, so far, so good. I actually sent her that intro song a few days ago. You know, like I've said in the past, the best way to engage me is through music. You know, so we've been like exchanging songs. Yeah, I can legit have an entire conversation with you that I think if you know me well enough will make sense. Via song, you send me something and I'll reply with a song and you can, you know, that's a dope conversation for me. But anyway, I sent that one to her to let her know she was fucking with the goat,
nigga.
And I might erase all of that. I probably will. Y'all won't hear any of that. Anyway, yeah, I'm not that conceited. I just, I don't know. I feel like y'all like that shit and I'm trying new things, trying a lot of new things. There's been a lot of firsts in this new venture. But I'm gonna let things develop a bit, you know, and then we'll definitely have some things to discuss here on the show. I do want to say, understand, ladies, that if you enter a situation with a creative, it's coming out in the art, like one way or another, like in some shape, form, or fashion, like it's going to be talked about, the good and the bad, you know. So just fair warning, like, it's going to happen. Don't be mad. Anyway, segue game on 1,000. Speaking of relationships, I did want to talk. I tweeted some things this week about a situation I had with another of one of the most important relationships in a man's life. I mean, maybe specifically a black man's life. I know it's a very important relationship for me, and that's the relationship between me and my barber. That shit is like, it's sacred. It means something. I've talked before on this show about how like there have been times where I needed to get a haircut, but my barber wasn't available, and like having that pressure to make a decision about whether I'm gonna step out on my barber, like it really feels like tantamount to cheating. And, you know, is tantamount the right word? Like, did I use that correctly? I mean, I know that I used it correctly because I actually looked it up when I was writing all of this, but that feels like a running gag I have with the show, so I wanted to do it anyway. But yeah, man, I went to the barbershop the other day, and I had an appointment. It's weird now. Like, is that a common thing everywhere? Does you now have to make like appointments with barbers? I remember being a kid, like growing up, man, you just like showed up, and you know, asked how many you got or whatever. I mean, I guess that's the evolution of whatever. I don't know, but yeah, I had an appointment. And I got there, and then he came in, and you know, and he was on the phone. And then, you know, he called me over, you know, I sat down, And I started noticing, I'm not trying to, you know, eavesdrop on a man's conversation, but I'm right there and he ain't talking softly. So I noticed he was having a conversation with, I guess, like his baby mother about, like, you know, increasing the visitation or him being able to get his son more often. And it didn't exactly sound like, you know, shit was going exactly the way he wanted to go. And, you know, immediately, like, I got nervous. Like, I don't know. His haircuts are a big deal. You fuck my hair up, like, it's going to take a certain amount of time, you know, for it to come back, you know. I'm going to have to let that shit grow out and then have you or somebody else cut it again before I look normal. And, I was already nervous. Like, I'm like, your head is not in the game, dude. I need you here. You know, I need you here right now. I need you focused. Let's get this thing done. You know how I like my haircut. You know, we've gotten to that point. We have that relationship where you know me. You know what I like. You know what to do. I should be able to sit down. We knock this out and I can go on about my day. I'm going to give you your tip. Everything's going to be good. Transaction complete. You know, this is the relationship that we have. But I can see right now you're not focused. And that's worrying me. I should have got up. I should have just got up and left and be like, dude, like, work that out. I'll come back. Would that have been rude? That sounded like that would have been rude. But I didn't. And I ended up losing my beard for it. I think, you know, like I said, he might have just been distracted. Like, the first thing he asked me when he got off the phone and was getting ready to start the haircut was, man, when the last time you seen your kid? I was like, God damn it. Like, that's, I know, like, that's, like, he didn't, like, flip the switch in the barber mode. He was still on, he was still in the middle of that conversation while he was cutting my hair. But, yeah, so he actually, you know, started shaving the beard and then realized that that's not normally what I do. But by the end, it was too late, so he just had to finish it out. And so now I'm back to, like, the soul patch kind of thing, which I did for a while at one time, but I feel like I had evolved past that. Now I'm back. Got to wait a couple weeks. But yeah, I had a conversation with Drea from Drea's Point of View on Twitter. Just a brief conversation, but just, you know, about, you know, whether I got upset or whether I said anything. And I was like, nah, I didn't. You know, I don't know. That barber relationship is sacred to me. I realized he was going through something. So we had a little moment, you know, it'll grow back. I'll be all right. Maybe this would be something we laugh about somewhere down the line. I probably will bring it up, but at the moment was not the time. He was still in that place dealing with shit with his kid. So, I don't know. I just wanted to talk about that. That was an important part of my week. So the other thing that I've been dealing with a lot recently that I guess would be more of the main topic of this episode is... I've talked about it on the Define Functional podcast with me and Chad and Zay. You know, I've talked about it on here. I've talked about it, you know, in several different venues. But I have this reputation in, you know, certain circles I run in as being the whitest black man people know. And, yeah, man, like, you know, I don't know exactly how I feel about it. And it's been popping up a lot more recently, especially with, like, the relationship that I made, you know, that is starting to build. That person is in the circle. And so, you know, friends get to comment on it and stuff like that. And I know that, like, most people that say it, the people that say it to me mean it as a compliment, which is... on one end, the reason why I try not to be offended by it. And on another end, the very reason why it is offensive, like, that you somehow think by telling me I'm white, that should make me feel better about myself or something, as opposed to just being the black person that I am. It's a weird thing. It's a really weird thing. And so the comment was made, you know, with the young lady that I'm dating right now, that, you know, that she's too black for me. I was like, fuck. Like, is that really who I am? Like, you know, I don't know. I'm trying to figure this whole shit out. Like, I don't know. I think I maybe, and the code switching thing is, like, really in my head. This is the part of the episode I didn't script, so we're going all over the place. the code switching thing is really in my head, because I know I have a persona on this show. I listened to some old episodes with like me and Rich, and the way that worked, and you know, the personality that I have there. And then I know, like, when I'm in these different environments around different people, that it changes, you know. Chad and I had the conversation on the Define Functional podcast, episode 2, Define Racism, if you want to check it out. And he said some things that he was intending to be racist so that we could have this for the sake of the discussion, you know. So he said, and Chad is a white dude, he said that he was the blackest person that lived in our house, and I lived with a couple other, you know, black guys, and then he gave his reasons why, and they were the most racist reasons you could ever think of. It's like, he worked in the chicken place, he'd been to jail, and he got a white girlfriend. Like, these were the things that have to him quantified being black. And it's like, and he and I have had the conversation, and we had the conversation during that show about like the N word,
nigga,
and and, you know, how often I use it or how often I don't use it. And I'm realizing that, like, I haven't said it a lot recently. And I think it's mostly because of the company that I keep, the people that I'm around. You know, I think if these same folks saw me in a different environment, saw me around my people, saw me around, you know, back when I was doing the show with Rich, like, probably is like 2/3 of my vocabulary. But, you know, around them, like, the switch just flips, and I don't say it for whatever reason. Maybe I'm not comfortable saying it around them. Maybe I don't want them to become comfortable with it. I don't know. But yeah, people say these things to me like I'm the whitest black man they know. And I find myself like scrambling to be black. And I hate that too, because I feel like that's like internal racism. Like, I'm trying to find these ways to fit the stereotype that you have about, you know, where I come from and who I am. And, you know, and usually it is like changing the way I talk, you know. I'm talking through this, people, because it's really weird to me, because in certain circles, that is the way I talk, you know. And so I don't know if that means I'm more comfortable there or if I'm doing what I need to do to fit in there. And then when I'm around these other folks, if I change up, because that's going to make them more comfortable, which makes me more comfortable, or if that's who I really am. Like, it is really like an identity crisis right now, this whole, like, you know, how white am I? And then, you know, this relationship has brought up, you know, a lot of it, because I'm noticing, like, how things that I'm into and stuff that I want to do and conversations that I'm interested in having don't fit those stereotypes. So, like, you know, like the other day, I'm looking for something, you know, for me and this young lady to do over the weekend. And, you know, because ain't shit happening to me in a fucking pandemic. So I found like this drive-in theater that was showing Moonrise Kingdom. That's a Wes Anderson film. I'm a big Wes Anderson fan. I love, you know, all of his movies. So I'm like, this would be dope, you know, we can go. You know, it's a drive-in type situation. It's out in the woods. That'll be, you know, nice. It felt like a good situation for me. It was a comedy. You know, it's a director that I like. I like these movies. I've seen the movie before, but I just like the movies. I think they're cool. So, you know, I hit her up and I was like, you know, do you like Wes Anderson films? And I was like, who? And I realized, you know, like, I don't know, is having a favorite director or like, you know, I think it just added to that persona of, oh, he is again with that white shit. And then we had a conversation about Anne Hathaway. And, of course, you know, if you follow the podcast, you know my feelings on Anne Hathaway and how she butchered Les Miserables. And one of my, you know, I'm big into show tunes and musicals. I don't know if I come across more white or more gay. I'm not sure. But anyway, I'm big into, like, musicals and show tunes. And that's one of my favorite musicals. And I watched that movie, and she was trying to, like, cry and shit while she was singing the song, and it's not the way you do it. She butchered the song. Like, it was horrible. It was horrible. So I have a thing against Anne Hathaway. And we had that whole conversation. And, again, I think it just, like, furthered that perception of me. And it's like, I don't know why I have this thing right now where I want people to see me differently. Like, I don't want to be seen as the whitest black man that you know. I want you to know, you know, I'm black. And this is where I come from. And this is how I talk. And this is what I do. But it's like, why do I feel the need to help them see me as more of what they expect me to be versus who, you know, I am? I think part of it is me still trying to figure out, like, you know, what parts of me are my normal baseline personality and what parts of me are the things I do to fit in. And that speaks a lot to blackness to me. Like, I don't think everybody understands that we don't live in a world right now where as a black person, you get to be yourself at all times. You kind of have to navigate. You have to switch. You have to change. You have to adapt to certain situations. I think, you know, Killer Mike said it the best recently with all these shootings. It's like, the lesson that we're being taught right now is, black people, if you don't make me feel comfortable, I will kill you. And I don't know that everybody, like, is aware that, you know, that's a thing. That's life. And so I enter situations, you know, you want people around you to be comfortable with you. And you sometimes, you know, at least I do, I change up to make people more comfortable with me because it makes me more comfortable. I don't want to be afraid. I don't want to be worried. I don't want to be an outcast. I don't want to be different. It's a whole lot of things that go into it. So I don't know. I'm trying to figure out this whole whitest black man thing. But yeah, people, it's not a compliment. Like, it's not a compliment. It really does come across as very superior. Like, because what would be the compliment to a white person? What race could I tell you you were that would make you feel better than white? It ain't one. See, exactly. So that's why it's not a compliment. You know. So I get your intent. And so because of your intent, I'm excusing it and I don't make issue out of it. I probably should, but I don't, because I understand your intent. But if you really thought about what you were saying, you realize it wasn't a compliment. And this is the shit that I think about after y'all say that dumb shit to me. But anyway, I digress. I did want to touch on one more thing before we leave here today. And that is a very important piece of advice I have to people. And this is, I don't understand why people can't grasp this concept. But, you know, when in doubt,
shut the
fuck up. This is the hardest thing in the world for me to try to explain to people, and I don't understand why. You know, people would not know things about you or have ammunition to do some of the things they do to you if you didn't give it to them. And I know this is all hypocritical because I just did an entire, like, show, and I have 187 of them of me telling you my personal business, but there's still some things, you know, even in this show today that I'm keeping, you know, close to my chest, like, that I'm not exposing for very particular reasons, very specific reasons. But yeah, in so many situations, like, things will work out so much better for you if you just shut the fuck up. Like, if you just didn't say anything, like, if you didn't try to, you know, if you didn't try to control the narrative, or you didn't try to exert some sort of control over the situation by, like, getting involved in it, if you just fell back and let things play out the way they're going to play out, a lot of things will work better for you. There's a whole, like, Facebook ad for these lawyers where they're talking about, like, you know, for people who work in dispensaries, and, like, if your dispensary gets raided, like, if it's not legit and it gets raided, shut the fuck up. You know, they don't know that you work there. You could just be a customer. Like, unless you tell them, they don't know. Shut the fuck up. 9 times out of 10, if you don't say anything, you know, we can handle it for you. You know, and I've had that happen a lot recently with certain things where I'm just like, man, if you didn't tell anybody that's what you were doing, nobody would know, and you wouldn't face any backlash for it. The only reason people know is what you're doing, and the only reason you're in this situation having to, like, defend yourself now is because you told everybody, just shut the fuck up. It's nobody's business. You don't have to tell people everything. Keep it to yourself. But I know, like, this social media, Facebook age has just made it where we feel like we got to say everything to everybody all the time, and you don't. shut the fuck up. Stop talking. Have a tight circle. You know, if there are things you need to get off your chest, keep it in that circle. I was talking to my roommate last night in my circle. I need for everybody to be dirty. You know, everybody got to know something about everybody else. If you clean, if you don't got no vices, if you ain't got no issues, if you ain't got nothing, I ain't got no dirt on you. Fuck you. I don't want you in my circle. I don't trust you. I need everybody to be dirty. I need everybody to know something about the other person that they don't want to get out. And if we all keeping each other secrets, we all good. But that takes a very tight circle because one person break, you know, everybody nervous. But, see, man, just shut up and stop talking. Stop telling everybody your business. I don't understand why that's difficult for folks. I wouldn't know. Like, I'm in certain leadership positions, and people will call me to ask me, you know, is something that they really want to do, like, against the brand. This is bad advice, but I tell people all the time, like, I wouldn't know you was breaking the rule if you didn't call me to ask me about you breaking the rule. I wouldn't know. There would be no, you would face no consequences because I'm not digging in your business. You brought this to me. You created the situation where now I have to investigate. Whereas if you had shut the fuck up, nobody would have ever known. That's my piece of advice for people. Shut the fuck up. And especially if you think of letting me know I'm the whitest black person, you know that's the perfect time to shut the fuck up.
Shut the
fuck up. Listen to Dave. All right, so with that said, I think we're going to go ahead and get out of here. Run through the usual calls to action. TTCharities.org. Please, if you're looking for ways to be impactful, if you're looking for ways to use your voice in a positive way and not just telling everybody your business, hit up TTCharities.org. Donate what you can, time, money, books, clothing, a repost, a retweet, a like, a share. It all helps. But TTCharities.org. Take care of your people. If you're looking for fitness or nutrition advice, Zaya Fitness on Instagram, Zayah Fitness. He can be your fitness, you know, nutrition coach, help you achieve your goals, your weight loss goals, your body goals, whatever it is. I think he pulled his back the other day trying to lift too much, but it's not a knock on him. It happens. It's going to happen. If you ride, you're going to fall. Like, that's what's going to happen. Anyway, what is TWS podcast available anywhere you listen to podcasts? Please subscribe. And if you like what you heard today, you know, leave me a rating, leave me a review. I really appreciate it. If you didn't like what you heard, review it anyway. So I know what it is that, you know, is turning people away. I ain't gonna change it, but it's good to know. We got merch. What is TWS.com? Hit up the store. Coupon code hoodie season is still in effect. HOODIESZN will get you 20% off your entire order. So do that. Get some merch. Define functional. Haven't put an episode out in a while, but I need to get the guys together so we can sit down and have another conversation. I really am looking forward to, you know, fleshing that podcast out. But yeah, and if you're interested in being on the podcast, please hit me up. Flan, FLAN, at whatistws.com. But that's really all I got. I appreciate y'all rocking out with me for a while. And I don't know, I'm gonna play this last little clip. I guess I'm in a relationship mood right now, so that's what we're doing, some Odyssey. But until we speak again, be safe, be light, be easy. Love you.
Hope that you answer my how you been, but can't complain. Any other response and I'll probably hop on a plane. Probably knock on your door, probably give you advice. End up spending the night and then fall in love with you twice. Yeah, my phone bill crazy.